I'd already been working for 7-8 years, and I'd seen many pug marks and their spray marks. But this time I heard a snow leopard roar. It was echoing in the valley, but we could not spot it. That event left a very deep mark on my memory. I think the first time I went to the mountains was when I was 18, and I was just struck by the beauty and the awesomeness. It's just absolutely mind-blowing, and that's what attracts me. This is a very ecologically harsh area, so eking out a subsistence is very difficult. Pastoral people have a very special rivalry with predators based on that this is a threat to their economic livelihood. Local farmers say that if you compensate us for our losses, then we will leave the snow leopard alone. We started in 1999 in one village. We applied for the Rolex award, and the money that we got, we expanded the project in 10 more valleys. It's about 15,000 people that our project is reaching out to. There are basically three components of our project. Number one is compensation schemes. I remember specifically this old lady, she came and kissed my hand, and she said that she had 11 goats that were killed by a snow leopard. Our project gave her the compensation to rebuild her herd. That was something, you know, where I felt, ooh, you know, maybe we are doing something good. The second component is predator-proof corrals. The third is population monitoring through camera trapping and genetic analysis. My students said, why is it that snow leopards do all these kinds of performances? And I tell them, we try to put our cameras where we think that snow leopards visit. You go and retrieve your cameras, keeping your fingers crossed, put that memory card in your computer, and voila, there it is. The difficulty of studying the snow leopard in its very rugged and harsh habitat is a challenge that drives me. We are sure that snow leopard population is doing very well and it's stable. And this has been a trend that we've been seeing for the last 10 years. That gives us hope.